The person with whom I am going to interact today needs no introduction. A great chemist. His has been a life in science. He's been the president of International Union of Crystallography. And he knows not only science as pure science, but also science in the context of the society, the nation, and dharma. So this interaction is going to be as much about science as it is about the social and the cultural context of science. Generally, there is a gap between science and the society and the general culture of the society. This gap has created a space for the breeding of vested interests. Filling this gap is necessary for the health of the society, for the mental health of the society, for the cultural vibrance of the society, and for the spiritual progress of the society. So in all these counts, Dr. Desi Raju stands as a very important person. With his vast experience, extraordinary intellect, and a dedicated life with the dharmic values. So let us have an interaction with Dr. Desi Raju. I welcome Dr. Desi Raju. Namaste, doctor.
Namaste, namaste. How are you, Aravindan? I'm happy to speak with you in the Atharva Forum, and which is a place which is quickly developing a very good reputation for bringing out very balanced presentations. And of course, this is not the first time I have appeared for Atharva. Several months ago, I spoke about a very contemporary problem, namely the scarcity of copper in India. And so today I'm happy that we're getting together to be able to speak a little bit on topics of mutual interest.
Yes, sir. The topic of yours, yours has been a life in science. So the very first question I would like to ask you is this. What does it mean by a life in science? Because you have experienced it. You have experienced it at a time when science was developing in India. When I read your biographical account, I found something very interesting. When you were in the University of Hyderabad, it was almost in the middle of a forest. Like an Aranya, yes. You people were sitting in
the forest. We always used to joke in those days that we had Vanaprastha before Grihastha. It was like that, I'm sorry, yeah.
Yes, and so you have lived such a dedicated life for science, and you have seen how the institutions of science have been growing up in India. That is one part. Another part is, you are a person who always values values in life. So yours is also a dharmic life. So what does it mean to live a dharmic life in science and a science life in a dharmic society?
Science, dharma. See, you are comparing two things that are very different. Because compared to science, I think dharma is huge. Dharma is the entire canopy which sustains the universe. It is. I look at dharma, you know, as many of us would, and I find that the consistent theme that comes here is that dharma is something that sustains. And which is why I do believe that it's just not humans who have dharma, but everything animate, inanimate, human, non-human, everybody and everything have their dharma, because everybody sustains. Dharma also, I believe, is beyond religion in the in the conventional sense. Although our religion is called Sanatana Dharma, the name dharma itself, the dharma, we all know this, it's an untranslatable word. And the limitations of the English language, you know, really come in at this stage. And so different interpreters and commentators over the years, centuries, have talked about this dharma thing. And I think a simple working definition for ordinary people is something that sustains. And I think the other thing which I feel about dharma is that there is a certain balancing out among very natural tendencies in human beings. Let's go back to humans. I mean, if you again take various commentators from the earliest days, this balance, a very healthy balance, say, between, you know, abhyudaya on one hand and nishreyasa on the other. I think this is, or shall we say, pravritti and, you know, nivritti. So these two will get you to these places. One being the physical, economic, emotional, you know, everything to do with the mundane world, which gets you there and which is very, very important to lead your daily life and a prosperous life as an individual, as a society, everybody, everything. I think that is one side. And then you have this inner search, the nivritti, which I think all of us want. We're all seeking. The thing what I would like to say about dharma is that there is this balance. I mean, Radhakrishnan actually calls it a set of rules, you know. So it's a slightly longer quotation, but I thought it's useful, but it's very contemporary. He says, I mean, dharma, you know, is the route to artha, kama and moksha, in its, definitely it is. But then he says, while the spontaneous activities of artha and kama are to be accepted, their full values cannot be realized if their action is unrestrained. So you can't go behind artha and kama in an unrestrained manner. And that's where dharma comes in. There must be a rule, a guidance, a restraint. Dharma gives coherence and direction to the different activities of life. Coherence, direction. It is not a religious creed. Again, religion is English word. We don't have a proper translation in our culture. You know that word religion itself, religion, Hinduism, those words and all, we should just take it and throw them out. They have no, you know, relevance in this context. Dharma is such a huge thing. The whole canopy, I call it, canopy of the world. And I think in the sense of, and in this sense, when you read Mahabharata or something like that, this business of what is adharmic and how to avoid adharma, I think that is, I think, what people are trying to search for. Then we come to the smaller question of science, if you ask me. My own dharma is doing science. And therefore, I have tried to see that right from the beginning, whatever I have tried to do in science is within this, my understanding of this broad canopy. And this would, of course, mean ethical, moral behavior, mainly ethical, you know, because there are so many opportunities to do unethical things, especially the higher and higher you rise in science. I mean, it is people like Polanyi and others who have said that scientists don't necessarily have to be good people. And you, in a very limited modern context, you can be a good scientist who is a very bad human being. I mean, this is, you know, so this is the way in which we do science, or the kinds of priorities we have given. I've talked about this ego business that comes into the scientist's life, and you have pointed it out to me. No, it shouldn't be there, but it is there. So can we transcend the ego when we start doing science? Right now, we seem to be in a lower level of operation, where a little bit of ego, constructive ego, I call it, can bring you to a higher state of realization. And this comes in stages, some sort of a curiosity. I don't want to use the word healthy curiosity, unhealthy curiosity. Curiosity itself. You need to be a curious soul to get into science. I don't think that's the only thing you need to be, but certainly curiosity is important. And I have found that in order to do science, science is very iconoclastic. So anybody who wants to, who is scared of the existing order, who is scared of disturbing the existing order, a person who is scared to rock the boat, these are not people who do very well in science. They do up to a point. They do up to a point where their success depends on their technical expertise. But then, you know, there's a great deal of difference between, you know, Ren and Martin and a Shakespeare play. You know all the grammar rules, but that doesn't mean that you can write something that's interesting or important. So, I mean, I'm not saying a scientist should be an anarchist. So I'm choosing the words carefully. You shouldn't be scared of being iconoclastic. And don't forget that our dharma of science has got some very nice checks and balances. Our whole system of peer-reviewed publications, you know, today there's a lot of discussion on this COVID thing, this vaccine, whether these results have been peer-reviewed or not. And the question is that when the situation is so urgent, should you depend so much on peer review? I found that in 40 years of being in science, it could be a very bad system, but it's the best of the systems we have. Because if we didn't have peer review, you know, we have this business of preprints, putting things up, blogs, and above all, God forbid, the social media, this Facebook and Twitter and all that. See, then it becomes anarchy. So when you have a peer review system, we have journals which carry out the protocols of how to take publications, referee them, publish them. We have, that is our dharma of communicating something. So I have always respected the peer review system. Even when a paper of mine gets turned down by the referees, of course there is an initial disappointment. But then you start asking, why does the referee not like my paper? And then you start thinking a little bit more. Life of science, you say, life of science. Science, it must be a life of science. You can't be science, you can't do science like a job. No. You can't, like an IAS officer, a bank officer, or some chartered accountant. Yes, they may all be interested in their jobs. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that, but you know, many a time I'm told by my family members that I'll be, you know, sitting with them in the evening doing something, and they'll say, oh, you're thinking about some molecule. I'm not saying anything, mind you. Sometimes I may even be participating in the conversation. But those molecules and those crystals, they don't leave you. They don't leave you. So I don't want to use this trite thing, way of life or something. No, it's not a way of life. It is itself. It is it's really in you. And this is not, it is not, actually it is completely compatible with the idea of dharma. It is also my dharma to know when I should stop this thing and do something else, say with my family or my friends or anything else. It can't become an obsession or something like that. And I know some of my colleagues, in fact very reputed ones, and mostly abroad, not in India, who have allowed this thing to get the better of them. And after some time, it is, I don't want to call it addiction, but they can't even get out of it if they want to. So I think, again, once again, the word balance. Sustain, balance, your ability to reach up to your level. I think all this is very important. It's a kind of a long-winded answer, but your question also was very deep. So it needed a longish answer.
Just one addition, one observation to what you have said. When we are talking about Hindu Dharma and other religions, J.B.S. Haldane, the biologist and a polymath, he made a very interesting observation with respect to Hindu Dharma and other religions. He said they are proselytizing religions, whereas Hinduism as such is not a religion in terms of a proselytizing religion's perspective. It is attitude, a series of attitude towards the universe. Now, science through various domains is also essentially that, a series of attitude towards the universe. How you relate to the universe, how you study the universe, how you experience the universe. And in the case of Dharma, it is not just the outer universe, it is also the inner universe and the relation between these two. Coming to that, as you have mentioned correctly, that narcissistic tendency in science. It's not only but in science. Actually, if you look at the religious people, once they get into the sadhana, this narcissistic tendencies arise. The ego starts to become big. And in our Puranas, the Vahanas of the gods are always considered as the symbols of this ego. So you need ego, but at the same time, the ego should become a vehicle of something grand, something more costly, something more impersonal. Now, is it possible for, I have seen this meetings of George's version, the famous physicist. He said that when you are doing science, when you make a discovery, then the small self disappears. You are one with the discovery, and at that particular moment, you have a joy that can only be considered as an Advaitic experience. Dr. Desi Raju, from your experience, particularly your work on hydrogen bonding, for example, of course, without getting into the technical details, which the people like us cannot understand. Have you felt this joy of discovery, this disappearance of the small self and being one with the larger one?
Absolutely, absolutely. There's no two ways about it. I think Professor Sudarshan, a very rare individual who combined at the highest level science and dharmic values, and you know, he always talked about the personal experience. And I have been lucky enough over my 40-year career to have experienced something like that twice or possibly thrice. And I can tell you also how it happens. One shouldn't fight shy of this thing when it comes to you. You know, you're looking around and you see lots of things. You've worked in an area for some time. And generally, scientists are looking for explanations for certain natural phenomena. In a general sense, that at least in the physical and biological sciences, we tend to do that. Now, it is a truism that for many of these important problems, there will be a number of theories, hypotheses put forward to understand these phenomena. And it usually turns out that many of these explanations explain some of the big facts. When it comes to the smaller facts, that is when each thing starts looking different and you start getting a conflicting idea. So I have found in all these cases where I was involved in hydrogen bonding, you mentioned, a great deal of my scientific life has been involved in looking at this phenomenon of hydrogen bonding. And by the way, I would like to maybe modify slightly what you said. No science is difficult for, you know, anyone to understand. With regards to hydrogen bonding, let me say it's not very difficult to understand. I mean, let's look at it like this. Do you see this ruler? I'm trying to put this ruler here. So let us say there are two atoms here, yellow and white. And shall we say that they are things that have some sort of a negative charge on them. So normally they don't like to come near each other, because we all know that negative charges repel. Now then here comes our most important thing. This red thing, this little stapler that I put here, is the positively charged hydrogen that comes in between them. Now usually, so those two are negative, this is positive. It sits somewhere in the middle, or generally speaking, a little bit on one side. So this positive hydrogen between these two negative things is what we call hydrogen bond. Now, much of the work I have done is on this hydrogen bond, and especially those cases where, let us say, this yellow is not very negative, or both the yellow and white are not very negative, and the red also is not very positive. These are those weak bonds. We found in one case, I think it was in the middle 90s, there were some very delicate structures we were looking at, where, let us say, this yellow thing, there were two comparable examples where both the yellows were weak, but one was slightly weaker than the other.
No.
So even within the weak, there was some distinction. Mm. Then we found this red, which was weak.
Mm.
When it was slightly weaker than the other, it went away from that yellow.
Mm.
And when it was slightly not so weak, then it moved this way.
Mm.
And it was a beautiful structure, because this red thing was situated in some sort of cavity where it was quite free to move around, you know.
Mm.
So it was not that there was anything else constraining it. And so the so-called very delicate movement is something that we could catch exactly. So even in this week, you know, there's this famous name of Linus Pauling. He came many years before me. I've seen him in real life only once.
Mm.
So he said there is no such thing as weak hydrogen bonds. All hydrogen bonds are strong. So don't forget that. So everybody said Pauling is God, and okay, so we are now going to. So even among this week, there were two weeks. One is weaker than the other, and the one which is not so weak actually became like kind of strong. Now, these sorts of ideas, when it hits you, and when you see it actually in the data, then suddenly this was one of the moments which I got, when my God, this is the truth. This is the truth. What I have been chasing for, at that time, I was solidly working in the area of weak hydrogen bonds for at least 10 years. I said yes, because. And this I can say is a general thing, but when the thing explains very, very minor phenomena, very minor phenomena, then you can be sure that you are on the right track. It's like the Sherlock Holmes stories, you know. Some things are explained, but then suddenly Holmes will say, "Arey, did you watch how that, you know, that chap came here and his mustache was slightly, you know, bent in one direction." Nobody else would have noticed that, but only Holmes will notice. And the whole case will hinge on that weak thing. This is what has happened with the hydrogen bonds. In the beginning, when I tried to put forward some of these things, people said, there's nothing. There's no weak business, only strong. Pauling said so keep quiet. So start getting things like, so firstly, and I've also said, many of my students and associates have said, there are two times when the scientist feels happy. The first time, which is the smaller time, is when the work that he has done, you get published in a paper, and then you see the paper for the first time. You feel kind of happy that it finally appeared in print somewhere. But the bigger happiness is this personal thing which Sudarshan talked about, which is what you experience at a very personal level, the first time you see it. And then, you know, as what, you know, Ravakrishnan and others say, that you go from the moment of intellect to the moment of intuition. And then it is no longer knowledge, but it is certainty. You are actually, you become one with that hydrogen atom. There is no difference between you and that hydrogen atom. That identity is there, you know, between the two. You don't see any difference anymore. And then as quick as it comes, that moment goes away. So that's the beauty of it. And I guess this would happen in any field of endeavor. I don't think this is anything very particular about science or something like that. I think it is very real. And this, I think, is what Dr. Sudarshan meant when he was talking about personal experience. And people have said that, you know, scientists, I think, all over the world feel this. But there is a tendency among Western scientists, especially in recent times, to reduce this aspect. They don't want, and then they try to give an explanation for this moment of truth using reductionist language. Claiming that they found this whole thing through an absolutely logical deductive process, whereas actually they didn't. And the answer, why am I saying this? I'll take you back 150 years or more than that with this very famous chemist by the name of Kekulé. Kekulé was a German chemist, very famous man in his time. And he was very famous when he started looking at a particular problem of the days. This was around 1865, 1870, yes.
And the benzene ring.
Benzene, the structure of benzene. The problem with the benzene structure is that the everybody knew the formula was C6H6. C6H6 is the formula of benzene. But all the known compounds of which contained 6 carbon atoms in those days, they have like 14 hydrogen atoms. C6H14 is known. C6H12 is known. And so on. But C6H6, the formula, there is too little hydrogen in this thing. And according to the theories of that time, something with the formula of C6H6 should be terribly reactive. But benzene is not terribly reactive. It is quite a nice, stable compound. So the structure of benzene is something that seizing chemists of the time, and Kekulé was a very big chemist when he started working on this problem. And he kept thinking and thinking and thinking and thinking. And one day we are told, we are not told, he told us himself in the paper that he wrote the next morning. He was getting so tired, he was drowsing off to sleep. And there was a big fire in the fireplace in front of him. So imagine, he saw all these flames, you know, flames in front of him in that fireplace. He was half awake, half asleep. And then suddenly he saw a tongue of fire which went in a full circle. And he said, suddenly for a moment, he saw a snake fall, swallowing its own tail. And there is a word in English language for that. It's called Ouroboric. O-U-R-O-B-O-R-I-C. So it is when a snake swallows its own tail. So then he suddenly said, I was in a half awake, half asleep condition, and I was dreaming. And I was dreaming about this. And then suddenly he got the answer that all the theories of the structure of benzene, you know, they had all the atoms strung out one after the other. And therefore, you needed a lot of hydrogens to fill out the carbon atoms. If you take a chain and then close it on itself, then you see you need some lesser number of hydrogen atoms to fill it up. And so by forming that ring, which nobody thought of, nobody thought of the idea that a chain of carbon atoms can be in a line, but it can also close on itself to form a ring. So that ring came to him, that was the vital breakthrough. And the morning he wrote the paper, and he ends the paper by saying, You know, either I was dreaming, and then he says, gentlemen, let us dream. He was not scared to say that it was through a dream sequence that he got the answer. Today's chemists, today's physicists, scientists, I am sure they go through all these phases. The way it is written in the paper, that it is so sterile, so, you know, prim and proper. Oh, we did this, we did that. Oh, naturally, we are going to get this result. Oh, we got this result. Oh, it is so nice. We are so great. You know, if you look at old German papers written in the 19th century, they are very wild. Not only are they like Kekule, you know, they talk about their rivals. And then they say, oh, this man, Mr. X, sitting in Munich, he knows no chemistry. Otherwise, how could he have written something like this? You know, journal editors were accepting those things in those days. And I wish we see some of that again today. Because some of our scientific literature is way too sterile. And they don't give us the real feel of, you ask, no, life in science. These are the real moments, Aravindan. These are really the real moments. What we put in the papers and what we, you know, get recognized for later, that is a formal statement of all the things we have done. But again, it is that pravritti and nivritti coming, the balance between that. I think that is, and that's why I would say that Dr. Sudarshan was one of the highest practitioners at both levels of science. Even he also worked in an area called particle physics, which many scientists will concede is one of the most difficult areas to work in. Difficult. It's not an easy area to people joke that anybody in the world can teach himself or herself biology and become a biologist. And I would say that by this scale, particle physics is one of the most difficult areas. You can't teach yourself. You have to be taught that subject by experts in the field. You can't be taught by, you know, people at the middling level also, it won't work. So now, I think when you are in an area that difficult, the dharmic things come easier to you. I think when I started working in crystal engineering, weak hydrogen bonding, supramolecular chemistry, these were all indefinable subjects. They didn't belong properly to any particular domain of chemistry. My kind of chemistry, even till today, it cannot be neatly classified as an organic chemistry or inorganic chemistry or physical chemistry. And the thing I found later on is that, again, this is related to the ideas you are talking about.
Right.
When something is unclassifiable, when something is unclassifiable, then the chances are that there are some essential truths in that area. Unclassifiable means what? It means it doesn't fit into some known paradigm.
Right.
For you to go and find that paradigm, I say. You got research problems there.
Right.
Whereas I find today a number of chemists and scientists, they're so scared. I told you, no, they're scared to rock the boat. They'll sit in very orthodox partitions of organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry. Not that these are important. They are important, all right. But there is a room and space. I think the real leaps of imagination. You know, Kekule founded the whole subject of organic chemistry, but when in his starting moment, he was an iconoclast. He was throwing things out and he gave a totally new way of looking at it. Not be scared. In science, you should not be scared, because yes, somebody who is able to do it will come and prove you wrong. Then tomorrow you go and prove him or her wrong. It's okay. It's part of like, there's no right and wrong anyway. You know, the more you do science, you realize there's no right, no wrong, no truth, no untruth. It is simply some various steps of trying to reach some level. I think, coming back again and again to your first question, I'm glad you brought up Dr. Sudarshan, though, because I think it's a very important name. It's a name that should not be allowed to be forgotten so easily, not in India at any rate.
You talked about the Western scientists and this, and Western scientists and the way they look towards things in a very reductionist way. There is also, I find, another one problem. The famous Yella brother Subbarao, he was the first person to identify ATP. At that time, glycogen was considered as the major paradigm in the energy as the energy coin of the living systems. And he said he zeroed in on ATP, but he was denied the honor. We have the example of G.N. Ramachandran, post-independence, G.N. Ramachandran. He came with that triple helical structure for collagen. Again, it was ignored. And in the case of Lynn Margulis, she was a woman who came with the idea of endosymbiosis. Again, she was actually humiliated by the science community. You think this problem of orthodoxy, collective ego is also operating in science. Does it have this Western prejudice in it? Have you encountered it?
Yeah, I could add the name of Lisa Meitner, you know, the Hahn Meitner theory. And Lisa Meitner was Jewish in a climate in Germany which was very against the Jewish people. And oh, yes, it's there. Certainly, it's there. And the story of Yellaprakada Subbarao is really tragic. And see, he worked, Ramachandran also. They all worked in an era where some of these things were well entrenched. And no person of Indian origin was going to be taken seriously, no matter what they did. We were finally a colony, and we were being exploited pretty badly. And it also suits the interests of the colonial masters to perpetrate the idea that we are not capable of anything. I mean, why did Mahendralal Sarkar start the Indian Association for the Cultivation of Science? Because he said Calcutta University is simply becoming a place where the British are turning out clerks. And you see, the universities of Calcutta, Madras and Bombay, the research was not encouraged. It was not treated like Oxford and Cambridge. So when cultivation of science started, when universities like especially Delhi, Allahabad, Mysore, Andhra were started, the visionaries who started these universities emphasized research from the word go. In distinct contrast to Madras, Bombay and Calcutta universities. Somehow never came out of that old setup. My own institute, when it started, you know, coming together of the Dowager Maharani, J.N. Tata and Swami Vivekananda, you know, this magic combination of these three people. And I believe all should be given equal credit. And usually there is a tendency to give all the credit to Tata, or sometimes to Vivekananda. People forget about Maharani. In 10 minutes, she agreed to hand over 400 acres of land, without which we wouldn't have got an institute. And then, so these three people had to come together. And it was again set up with the idea of having a research atmosphere in a country that was realized that the colonial thing cannot go on the way the British came in the beginning. Oh, yes, Aravindan. It's always been there, and I have felt it also. And I'm happy to say that people younger than me, gradually this is coming down. And I think the most important reason it's coming down is that the presence of people of Indian origin in all those countries who are very successful economically, the emergence of India as an economic power. Okay, we are not yet China. No reason why we can't be, if we play our cards correctly. Science is done best in rich countries. And there's no getting away from it. And the richer you become in general, the more seriously you are taken. Because finally, in the end, it's whether we like it or not, it's money that rules the modern world. So when you tell me about the Ramchandran also, I mean, Ramchandran is a bit closer to me because the area is related, and I know many of the people, I knew many of the people who were in personal contact with Ramchandran. I myself have been privileged to talk with him on two occasions. It's a much more tragic story, and he might have been able to handle his situation better than he did. But perhaps he, I don't know, this is my personal opinion. I felt that he was more conscious of getting approval from white people than he need have been. You know, and this is something I learned from him also. I mean, as you go along, you learn from others. And I was lucky to have been born, say, 5 years after independence. The British influence was still very much there. I can, half the teachers in my school in Bombay came from Britain. So I saw them very frequently. It was not a distant memory. But at the same time, I think we, the post-Midnight's children, I think we had a way of looking at white people in a slightly different way. I mean, it was, the colonial mentality was still there. I mean, people say it is still there today, and I fear it is. But by and large, you know, you, by the time it came to my son's generation, they don't even know who the British were. It's just some other country. Today it's become a very poor, small island off the coast of Europe. I think that's how you should really. And it is not every foreign country. I will, specifically it is Britain, because they ruled us. So their attitude to us is very peculiar. Our attitude to them is still rather peculiar. So I wouldn't bring in the Americans or the Germans or the Japanese. If we can shake off this bugaboo of Britain from our minds completely, then I think many of these things, because finally it's on your attitude, you know. A very famous Nobel laureate, in my first days of interaction with him, because now I know him very well, but in almost one of my first interactions with him, he said, you are a very unusual person. I said, why? He said that, you're the first Indian I've met who doesn't talk to me in a cringing, over-respectful way. I was not very old then, you know. I was not very old. And so this is just it. I mean, people behave to, with you the way in which you behave to them. If you're confident enough about your work, then it should not matter with whom you're talking. I think this is the real point which you mentioned. It's still there. But it's far less now. I think in the last 20 years, at post-91, as India became more significant economically for those guys, I think they have gradually and somewhat unwillingly learnt to accept our presence. And even now, when in the cases of blatant plagiarism and irregularities committed in India, these things get wide publicity internationally, because somehow, you know, oh, these guys are only capable of this, and oh, we always knew about this about Indians. I mean, they don't say this about Chinese and other people. So it's a touchy topic. And I think with the passage of generations, I think if we can throw that particular island out of our mentality, then I think much of this will be just an academic historical discussion. It's only that island, no, nothing else.
Professor, when we were talking, you pointed out one particular aspect of Dharma, that we should use this particular, that mandala of where you have no particular categories, but it is a continuous thing. The continuity that is the basis of Dharma.
That mandala is, I found to be very interesting. I mean, it's just a friendly quiz that anybody can take. But if you look at the two axes, horizontal axis, I believe, is your temperament as to whether you are international, national, or nativistic. International, nationalistic, nativistic was the horizontal axis. And I think the vertical axis was that, are you in favor of very limited personal liberties, or you like the government to come in now and then to curtail your personal liberties, or you want totally unrestricted personal liberties? So since you have three categories in the horizontal axis and three in the vertical axis, you have nine squares. And I went through these nine squares, and I found myself appearing in that middle square, that gray square. And I found many people, many situations, many countries in each of these nine squares. And it's a nice exercise for people to actually try to put, if you take some of the leftist elements in the USA today, who are doing so many strange things, you can easily fit them there. I could fit Singapore very, very easily as a country which is highly internationalist, but where there are almost no personal liberties. So like, some countries fall very nicely into these nine squares, others don't. And I was very happy that I found myself in that middle gray square. And I want to call that as Dharmakshetra. And similarly, you need a balance between total control like China and Singapore and wild liberties like what our Tukde and all want. They want anything. They don't want, anybody can do anything. So there has to be a balance. And this balance is what, like earlier in this discussion, I spoke about what Dr. Radhakrishnan had said about that system of rules, system of balance. What is there in the Quran? What is there in Gita? The balance is required. So balance is the middle thing, middle point. So I really think that is our Dharmakshetra. I think all of us, if we are there, then there's nothing to prevent this country from really coming up in a big style. And so the responsibility, the individual, it's on society, it's on, it's on the whole country.
That is a very interesting.
It came up recently, so I thought we'll bring it into this thing. And usually,
recently I came across a very interesting book. It was written by a professor of philosophy of science, history of the philosophy of science. His name is Smith. His name is Justin Smith. The name of the book itself is Irrationality. Yeah, Irrationality. The name of the book is Irrationality. What he says is the Western rationality is founded on two pillars, discrete groups, and there is no middle. There is no middle between two opposites. Now, when I read that book, and he says that this has created a lot of disasters in the history of the Western society, and we have to find out means of different types of rationalities. When I read this, I remembered one aspect from our Puranas. When Hiranyakasipu wanted a boon, he always went for these discrete groups. He said, I should not be killed in the morning daylight, not in the night. He never found there is a place called Santhya. He said, I should not be killed outside, I should not be killed inside. He never thought about the middle. So it is this middle that he neglected. In fact, all these people, they stick on to these binary groups. And in this connection, recently there was a paper that you said that you were also interested in, that that the hydrogen bonds and the covalent bonds, they are not two different categories, but they also form a continuum. So essentially, it is the search for the continuum, the search for, as you said, a gray common continuum, instead of looking at people as different enemies or different sect of people whom you have to convert to your own sect. And you have to make sure that there are no differences. Everything should be homogenized. everybody should get converted to a particular belief system. Like in the case of Marxism, when they found that quantum mechanics is against dialectical materialism, entire quantum mechanics should be branded as capitalist science and destroyed. So this kind of tendencies, this arise from this, what you can call a binary mindset, a mindset that doesn't look into the continuum. And science, does it help us? For example, if I am making my children get taught in this aspect of science, and I think it was Gothari, the famous physicist from and an educationist, he said that the complementarity principle of quantum mechanics resonates very well with the Hindu darshanas and the Jain darshanas, and it should be taught in science at all levels, at different for art, for science, for humanities, it should be taught. Can you think of such a curriculum for all students, irrespective of whether they are art students or science students?
Certainly, certainly. I don't think it's very difficult also. I don't think it's very difficult to put a curriculum like this. When you talk about six darshanas, I mean, if it, this can be told to a very young person with a simple meaning that the same thing can be looked at in so many different ways. And the fact that nothing is what it seems. And that there is no disunity among people in thinking like this. This binary thing certainly has become, in recent times, things were not this binary, Aravindan, even 10 years ago. Today you find family members who refuse to talk to each other because they have slightly different political views. You know, I've known of many friends who have simply stopped talking to one another because of the same reason. This should not happen. It's very bad for a country and very bad for a society, bad for an individual. On the other hand, I'll put a small caveat though to what you're saying. In day-to-day governance, day-to-day management, administration, executive actions of the kind that India needs so badly today, your middle path won't work. Middle path in the hands of mediocre Indians becomes a big soup of mediocrity, obfuscation, and a tendency to avoid taking tough decisions. You know, we've seen several examples in the last year or so where many people might have felt that certain tough decisions should have been taken and they were not, simply because in some maybe imagined way that there is some middle path that will suit everyone. I mean, it was Swami Vivekananda who said that if you keep going on and you face no problems, then it certainly means you are on the wrong path. So, the right path has problems. Governments, especially executive people, should not worry too much about this middle path. This middle path has what has destroyed India at an operational level. Because in a country like this, you will not have agreement, 100% agreement, among all the people on all the things. India is very much a 65% country. If you can get 65% agreement among 65% of the people, then I think you are doing quite well in India. So searching for 100% agreement among 100% of the people is simply a very sly way of saying that you don't want to take a decision. I mean, this is a quite a different level from what you have spoken. At the levels at which you are speaking, yes. In terms of human relationships, in terms of a relationship of a man or woman with their chosen field of endeavor, in terms of broad societal things that, you know, we have to, it is said that in our overemphasis on the individual in our Sanatana Dharma, we have forgotten the societal responsibilities of Sanatan Dharma, which are there, you know, we have forgotten it. So that we are not able to look at something in its wholeness and in its fullness. What you have said is correct, but I think please add this caveat also as pertains to day-to-day operational things done by executive governments. That there the middle path will destroy this country. It will, because this country has come to a point where very tough decisions are needed for certain things. And the more and more we get scared of taking those tough decisions, the more and more of a mess we will get into.
Before Kurukshetra, Krishna should go for a peace mission. Strive for peace at all levels. But once at Kurukshetra, it should be a war. That is what you are saying, right?
Exactly. I mean, it's there. It's there in our shastras. Give everything the chance. But at that point, don't start saying, everybody is my brother. You know, he's not. Mm. He's your enemy. Mm. And inability to distinguish between friends and enemies on huge moral or economic or whatever grounds today, I think is really what is. It could also be because we have not been taught our shastras and other things properly in a way that is meaningful to young children who will then become tomorrow's young adults. It could also be a lack of that. And so one thing cause leads to an effect and so on, and that leads to a new cause. So I'm afraid we're pretty much still in that kind of a frame and mindset. But I'm a great optimist, and I think economic prosperity is something that will iron out many of these things. So it is a whole cycle, you know. Without the economy, you know, you will not get into a... Because finally, all these are the higher things. It's the icing on the cake. It's not the cake itself. Or maybe it is the cake and we don't realize it. But still, you need to have a breakthrough in this vicious circle. And I think that is, it's also the message of science. Because science is a very non-linear activity. It is something that can help you to break through these vicious. The hard sciences have a way of breaking through the vicious circles created by the social sciences. Let me put it like that.
That is a very wonderful way of putting it, sir. So, thank you very much for this interaction. It has been a real pleasure talking these things. So, again, I hope we'll meet in the same forum and discuss things.
And I'm very happy to speak with you, Arvindan, having read so many of your things in the past. And this first interaction was most pleasant. And I would like to thank the Atharva Forum for having made this opportunity possible.
Thank you so much, sir. It has been a honor and a pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.